Welcome to tonight's show. All right. Featuring musical guests Liz Landau, scientist Dr. John Cook, stand-up comedian Noah Crowley, and a few special guests. Now here's your host, Kasha Patel.
Hi everyone, thank you very much. It's so nice of you to be here with me. We have a very special show today. We're celebrating Earth Day, the annual event where we relearn the rules of recycling. This is the 50th anniversary. Earth Day is actually the largest civic observance in the world, just edging out the series finale of Game of Thrones. I do think it's weird, though, how we celebrate Earth Day. Every year, we plant trees and pick up litter. We celebrate Earth Day the same way people who commit petty crimes get punished, with 24 hours of community service. But of course, we can't do that this year. We can't go out because of the quarantine. I've been in lockdown for about 40 days, which is a long time. It's been a lot of video conferencing. If we've learned one thing from Zoom though, it's that MTV Cribs with non-famous people would be extremely lame. As you know, COVID-19 originated in China and has since spread across the world. First, China gave us TikTok, and now COVID-19, and we can't get rid of either. It's interesting, though, that we're celebrating Earth Day under a quarantine where we have to stay at home. During the quarantines, air pollution levels have actually dropped noticeably in China, India, the United States, and parts of Europe. All we had to do was stop cars, buses, air
going
traffic,
to work,
restaurants,
going to malls,
dentist clubs, my parents' house,
pretty much anything non-essential or fun.
The best thing we can do is to just sit there and do nothing, which is why I decided to bring you this comedy show, the most sustainable Earth Day comedy show ever. Environmentally sustainable, not financially. These stars cost a lot of money, so please donate. In recent decades, the health of Earth has been declining in many different ways. The last 5 years have been the warmest on record. The only other thing to be that consistently record-breaking is Taylor Swift. And like climate change, Taylor Swift was also human-caused. I also read that 1 out of 3 species is going to go extinct in the next 50 years. So I would like to nominate some species. I feel like 1 would be the Kardashians. 2 would be people who would pay to see Tiger King turned into a movie. And the last group would just be people who don't believe in climate change. But I feel like that one will take care of itself. The environmental movement actually started in the 60s with a book by Rachel Carson called Silent Spring. In the first 2 months, it sold 100,000 copies, which is impressive because it didn't talk about zombies or vampires at all, unless you count the mention of chemical companies and the US government. Earth Day was created after Silent Spring, and in an era where humans were doing incredible things. A year before the first Earth Day, we landed on the moon and left our mark. Scientists estimate that those footprints will last for 1 million years, which is the longest example of a man not cleaning up after himself. And we've been progressing with the field of exploration and space exploration. To me, NASA is a lot like church. We're both trying to find a way to leave Earth. But there's no guarantee that finding life on another planet or colonizing another planet will occur. And even if it does, would it even help us? Would we be able to adapt so quickly as a society? I mean, I'm just saying, there's a lot of Americans who still haven't bothered to learn Spanish. All I'm trying to say is I'm not ready to give up on Earth yet. Earth is beautiful and scary and has the best Netflix documentaries. It's also naturally fascinating. Earth has 3 layers, the crust, the mantle, and the core. And at its core, Earth is made up of magnesium and iron and tweets that get less than 5 likes.
It's actually this outer core, this molten core, that creates a magnetic field that protects Earth from all these external particles just trying to infiltrate and penetrate inside. Apparently, I had a personal magnetic field throughout high school. Mother Earth is one of my top two favorite mothers, right after my mother Patel. And you know, sometimes I can't help but think that maybe if Mother Earth was a little more like a frugal Indian mother, we wouldn't have this problem. Why are you trying to dig and extract oil? Use the wind, it's much cheaper. My mom is not going to like that joke. All right, guys, thank you very much. We have a very exciting show for you with wonderful guests. Stick around after the break.
This is sponsored content because we really need the money.
Hey everyone, I am back. It's me, Hannah Hamilton, your favorite blogger, and I'm gonna go over some of the amazing products that I picked up on my trip to the Saudi oil field. It's incredible. Okay, so here's the thing is like everyone should really be stocking up on oil right now because it is super cheap and you can get like a whole barrel of this stuff. And let me tell you, my skin has never been clearer. So first of all, did you know that you could turn your petroleum into brow gel? I mean, check this out. Oh my God. It's like the exact same color as my eyebrows. Who knew? Who knew that gasoline could just like really light up the brows like that, huh? Next up, I'm gonna use this amazing palette for my eyeshadow where it's actually made out of coal. Could really go for a smoky eye in that charcoal kind of shade. It comes from the earth. I mean, I'm pretty sure about that. So, you know, my guess there is that it's probably sustainable, you know? So that's like good. I mean, it's like clean beauty, you know? You just you get it out of the earth. Ooh, look at that. Mwah. And this right here is a little antifreeze in a tube, which will actually plump your lips up like a ton, but you know, just be careful with it because it's antifreeze, yeah. And then you just seal it all in with a nice layer of petroleum jelly. And look at that, my face is looking so fresh. I'm gonna wait to do my hair because my face is super flammable right now.
And now for an uplifting song, not about Earth.
The song was inspired by What a Wonderful World. I see. Spacecraft launch. They're flying so far. Someday they'll go. Globes with orbits so tight, each one
Kasha Patel.
And I'm Joe Dawson.
And welcome to Science Roundup. All the latest scientific studies and research explained to you in voices that sound important. It's just like the 6 o'clock news, except we know that data are plural. Here are the headlines.
A new oral hormone-blocking drug may help with heavy menstrual bleeding. Progress on the research was delayed for years when male scientists said, "Ew, don't talk about that."
A recent study shows that bees pollinate flowers better in the city than in the countryside. Perhaps the bees are just attracted to the larger dating pool on Bumble.
A new study predicts that a transition to wood products in the construction of buildings would offset enormous amounts of carbon related to steel and concrete production. My God, he healed a nation and predicted the future.
A new self-assembling 3D battery could charge in seconds. In keeping with tradition, Apple says they want no part of it.
University of Helsinki research suggests that trees might be aware of their size. And if you're a tree self-conscious about your size, look out for my online resistance training series for trees, Soul Stumps!
Research shows that men who are argumentative, disagreeable, unempathetic, and stubborn are more likely to own a high-status car. Joe, don't you own a Model 3 Tesla?
No, Kasha, it's the Tesla Model X. They're completely different cars. They're dumb, and this study is dumb, frankly. Men who own expensive cars are disagreeable. I disagree!
Scientists from The Ohio State University compared three popular brands of water pitcher filters and found that some are better at removing toxins than others. The study took longer than expected, though, because the researchers' roommates kept forgetting to refill the water pitchers.
A study finds that even extinguished cigarettes give off toxins. This new form of cigarette exposure has been labeled after smoke, or butt emissions. And my sympathy to the DARE officer who has to warn middle schoolers about the dangers of butt emissions.
A self-learning heating control system saves energy in buildings by controlling the thermostat. If AI controlling your air conditioner sounds scary to you, you're not alone. James Cameron just began production on Terminator 7, where the Terminator must go back and find Sarah Connor and give her a cardigan.
Canadian researchers develop a faster test for cannabis quality. Well, leave it to Canadians to make weed nerdy.
Engineers have created a device that sends rotten food warnings to smartphones, letting consumers and food distributors know when meats and other perishables have gone bad. It's kind of like your roommate texting you when the bathroom's off limits.
UCLA researchers have joined with sushi restaurants to cut back on seafood fraud. But first, they'll have to track down a notorious gang of fish fraudsters. Al Carpone, Whitey Fish Bulger, John Coddy, Eel Chapo, and a mysterious figure known only as the Codfather.
A study showed providing free eyeglasses to kids in China actually improved their math scores. What a punch to the gut for the US. China was beating us in math they could barely see.
Strawberries could help reduce harmful inflammation in the colon, but you have to put them in your mouth.
Men's testosterone levels are largely determined by their environment during childhood, according to recent research. Boys who grew up in lockers had lower levels of testosterone. In a related study, estrogen levels are largely determined by how many seasons of Gilmore Girls you own.
A new artificial sensor that can detect surface shapes and structures mimics a human sense of touch. However, research faltered early on when scientists struggled to identify what human touch felt like.
One promising option for a more efficient, rechargeable battery is made out of sodium, which is abundant in seawater. Talk about a salted battery.
A new study shows that female short-tailed bats can size up a mate just by hearing his singing. Fellas, you can't go wrong with that all-time bat classic.
This is still sponsored content because, again, we really need the money. If you donate, we don't have to keep doing this.
What's up, everyone? I am back. It's me, Hannah Hamilton, your favorite travel, lifestyle, style, fashion, beauty, interior style influencer. Okay, so we're gonna do a little vacay rewind here. I didn't post the past couple days because I was out chillaxing in an oil field. Yeah, crazy, right? Well, I bet you're probably thinking, oh, that really doesn't sound like Hannah Hamilton's style. She's like more into luxurious things, and that's where you'd be wrong. It was luxurious. You guys don't know. There's like this whole world out there, and this oil field was not just oil. It was like living in liquid gold. And what's more luxurious than that? I was treated like a VIP. I even got chauffeured, blindfolded to this oil field because it's like still kind of being investigated. Oh my God, isn't this cute? Check this out. You could just like relax all day hanging out by the fields, and I had a great lounge chair where they brought me like oil themed drinks. And check this out, I got barrels and barrels of it every day. Wow, it even smells good, which like you didn't think would be true, but it totally is. Like, I'll just put it in the room, like a little room of therapy. I'll give you some more updates next time once I've started going through some of the products that I've gotten from my trip. You guys are amazing. Mwah! Peace out.
Now, I want to introduce a very special guest for our next segment. I had the chance to sit down with a scientist at George Mason University who studies the science of science communication. Please welcome Dr. John Cook.
Okay, great. Thank you so much for joining us. Today we have Dr. John Cook. So you have a couple of talks that you said you're doing on Earth Day. Obviously, this year's a little different. You have to do things virtually. In the past, what has been the favorite Earth Day plans that you've had? What have you done on Earth Day that you've really enjoyed in the past?
I guess the climate march in DC right. is probably the biggest thing I've been involved in. And the marches in DC are a lot bigger than the marches I've been involved in Australia. So that was certainly exciting.
Yeah, it's interesting for Earth Day this year. Normally, I spend my Earth Day around a lot more little kids because every year we always go to Union Station for work and we do a lot of public outreach things. And I remember one memorable event that I had was a few years ago, and you get a lot of school children, but every once in a while you get adults who are coming by, which is perfectly fine. But there was this one guy who came up to me, and I'm like trying to hand him like the pamphlets, do the science experiments or whatever. And he says, oh, I heard something about NASA. I heard that there's actually scientific evidence. It's this guy from Harvard. He found this out, that the satellites in space are actually controlling our minds. What do you have to say about that? And I was just like, I can tell you about precipitation. Like, I don't know anything about what you're saying. He's like, no, a guy from Harvard told me this. And then he had his cell phone, and it was so blatant that he was putting it in between us. Like, I could tell he was recording, and I was like, what am I supposed to do with this? Like, I have no idea what you're talking about. So Earth Day, you get a lot of, you get a lot of the people want to go out and do good. Then you have a lot of people who just want to test out their theories on you.
After we published a study in 2013, finding 97% consensus on climate change.
Right.
And it got a lot of attention, but also with good attention comes bad attention as well. And I started getting interesting emails. And I think my favorite email was a guy saying, humans aren't causing global warming. What's causing global warming is this small interstellar object. And I found it with my telescope. So he'd obviously found, I don't know, he saw something in his telescope, but that's causing global warming. So I was like, okay, that's an interesting letter.
Now, you and I have talked before about using humor to kind of combat misinformation and climate change and other topical issues. What's your interest in using humor?
So I came at it in a really meandering way. I started by doing psychological research through my PhD, and that research found that inoculation is the key to neutralizing misinformation. And then I started researching with critical thinking philosophers, well, how do you develop inoculations? And they introduced me to this idea of parallel argumentation, or basically using analogies. Take bad logic and transplant it into absurd situations. And prior to doing my PhD, I was a full-time cartoonist for over a decade. And I realized during this critical thinking research that cartoons were the perfect delivery mechanism for these parallel arguments, these inoculating debunkings.
So what was the decision to go from cartooning to a PhD?
Yeah, it wasn't really a decision. Like, I often characterize it as it was science that chose me rather than me choosing science. Because I was doing my cartooning, I was actually doing some graphic design work with my wife as well. And once at a family get-together with my wife's family, my father-in-law started throwing these climate denial arguments at me. And I went away from that lunch and started researching all the different climate denial arguments he was giving, and just looking at what the science said about each argument. Because I was determined to win the next argument, next time we had a family get together. And so I built this database of all the relevant scientific research about each cranky uncle argument that I might get from my father-in-law.
So you have created a book called Cranky Uncle versus Climate Change. So you really did have some kind of cranky uncle inspiration in your life.
Yeah, father-in-law, my own father, and I've actually drawn him in the book as well. There's a cartoon of him. I drew a cartoon of the moment when I told my dad that I was going from physics to cartooning, and he was like, son, if you do that, you're going to end up living on the streets wearing torn jeans. And so I used that as an example of slippery slope fallacy.
So explain a little bit about the slippery slope, the analogy that you used for that cartoon.
Yeah, I'm talking about, at that stage in the book, I'm talking about what drives climate denial. And the biggest predictor of climate denial by far is politics, our political ideology, our political affiliation. And the reason why is because people who deny climate science, it's not because of the science, it's actually because of the solutions to climate change that they don't like, because a lot of the solutions involve government regulation of the fossil fuel industry, and they don't like regulation of industry. And one of the arguments they use is, if we just do the smallest action, like even the smallest tax or regulation on industry, that's the first step down the slippery slope to the government taking over all of our lives. And so climate denial is really based on this foundation of the slippery slope fallacy.
Interesting. Even just hearing you say that small bit, I feel like I'm already understanding my relatives more. I was like, oh, I do hear them saying like, oh, what's next? They're going to tax us first and then everything's going to, yeah, the slippery slope. That's very interesting.
Yeah.
There's a lot of parallels between climate change denialism and what's going on right now with COVID-19, it appears. Is that correct?
Yeah, very much.
Can you give us an example of one of the most dangerous COVID-19 misconceptions that you tackled?
The myth is that because we've started to flatten the curve, because projections have been downgraded from 150,000 to 60,000, because things aren't necessarily as dire as earlier projections might have made, that means that we can relax social distancing and we can go back to normal. We can open America again. And the parallel argument was, it's the same as the weather forecast is for rain. So you take an umbrella and you're standing under the umbrella in the rain and you think, well, I'm dry. Obviously, the forecast was wrong. I can throw away this umbrella. And it's ignoring the fact that it's the umbrella itself that's keeping you dry.
If you had to have a person take away one or two things from your research about how to better communicate these difficult, controversial scientific topics, what would that be?
I think that the through line in all my research, whether it was the humor stuff or the non-humor stuff, is the importance of logic and critical thinking in countering misinformation. What I'm finding in my research is logic-based debunkings or logic-based inoculations just as effective, or even they can be more effective than facts in neutralizing misinformation.
So it sounds like you're constantly analyzing the logic and statements and what people are saying. Are you that but actually person?
No, definitely not. And like the number one rule about all this critical thinking and logic-based stuff is don't use it on your partner, because that's a world of pain. Like, although she does use it against me. Like, she'll go, "That's a false dichotomy, John." And I was like, "Damn it."
The student becomes the master. That's funny.
So people can find my book at crankyuncle.com. And the other big feature of that website is that we're also developing a Cranky Uncle game at the moment. But the goal of the game is to teach critical thinking.
Cool. I like how you took your tension with your father-in-law initially and made it into something for the greater good.
Yeah, well, something good came out of those initial fights, I guess.
Exactly. Great. Well, thank you so much, Dr. John Cook. This has been a pleasure.
Thanks, Kasha.
Please welcome comedian Noah Crowley.
The next performer, he's a comedian right here in the D.C. area, performs all over the DMV area. Give it up for Noah Crowley.
Oh, hello, science audience. You look wonderful tonight. It's been a fun year in science. It's also been sort of a terrifying year in science. Like, by round of applause, who here is worried about global warming? Everybody, right? It's terrifying. There are rising ocean levels. There's more hurricanes than ever before. But as much as you all might be concerned about global warming, there is an anxiety specific to myself and other dudes named Noah. And then, should I be building a boat right now? I gotta know. Like, I can ask all my friends, be like, "Hey, do you think I should be building a boat?" And they'll be like, no, that's crazy. I'm like, cool. But then you go and double check the Bible, I'm like, ooh, that's what all of his friends said too. This clears up nothing. And I've done none of the prep work either. Like, I'm supposed to be able to build an ark that's 40 cubits tall. I have no clue what a cubit is and no woodworking skills. I'm supposed to be gathering up two of every animals. I don't even have a girlfriend right now. I feel like that should be step one in this process. There's also technology taking over random parts of our life. Like, Venmo became an app. It's a Cash App. I don't know if you're all familiar with it. It was a good Cash App, and then they made it a social media app too for no apparent reason. And everyone's just lying on there as a result. Like, you'll see, like, messages come up like, "Sarah paid Cindy $10 for Coke and hookers. Tee-hee-hee." And you're like, $10 for Coke and hookers? That seems like quite the deal if I've ever heard one. That's just a pizza purchase right there if I've ever seen one. And then the other end of that spectrum would be like 12 a.m. and be like, "Greg paid John $100 for pizza." You're like, "That's a lot of pizza right there, John. This one's a drug deal if I've ever seen one. This is, we're all just lying on here about the same couple of things." It's also been a weird for, I've noticed the number of female robot voices in my life has gone off the charts. Like, there's Alexa, there's Siri. If you call up a phone number and get put on a wait list, it's always like a female voice talking to you to try and calm you down. And these are never voices you talk nicely to either. Like, day one with Alexa, you try. You're like, "Alexa, would you be a dear? Just turn the radio down just a smidge. Why, thank you." And then by day five, you're just yelling belligerently, like, "Alexa! You idiot! Turn the music down before I smash you into a million pieces. I am serious." Because you said serious, Siri pops up and wants to ask you a question. You're like, "No, Siri, I don't want to talk to you either. And Sarah, shut the goddamn door." And everyone's like, ooh, Sarah is your very human roommate with very human emotions. She is very upset with you right now. You have to go and apologize, be like, I'm sorry. This sounds like a very dumb Black Mirror episode, but it's all these lady robot voices making me angry. I don't know what else to tell you. Joke's fun because you can find out here who has Netflix. Black Mirror's weird too. It's a show about all the dangers of technology and how it's affecting our modern lives. And I only found out about it because technology had an algorithm that told me I'd like this show. I'm like, ooh, this does not seem good for the future of humanity right here. Also, I've been trying to keep science in my life, too. I run the occasional science experiment from time to time. For instance, my most common one is, could this be shampoo? You might have run this experiment, too, at home. Usually I'm just going through my life like I normally do, using shampoo until I run out. And then you have to, hypothesis, what else here could be shampoo? Example one, soap. Soap is usually the next step in line, is right there. It's basically shampoo. You can throw your head down your head and get out the door, fine. But one day I had a hot date that night, and I went to the shower and found I had already run through all of my shampoo and all of my soap. So I'm like, ooh, this is where the experiment gets interesting. What else here could be shampoo? So I looked around my apartment, and I've got a bulldog, and he's got a special bulldog shampoo. So I started going through the ingredient list. There was like tea tree oil, jojoba. This could be people shampoo too. So I don't know if you've ever been nervous for a first date, but have you also had the worry of, man, I really hope she doesn't notice I'm using dog shampoo? I feel like that's a real deal breaker right up top. And sure enough, as soon as we met on this date, she went in to hug me and smelled my hair and said, Noah, your hair smells amazing. What's your secret? And I had to act all coy about it, like, ooh, that feels like more of a third date conversation right there. Can't immediately reveal how I got this coat so shiny and lustrous. I can't promise you I am tick and flea free. It says so right on the bottle. That is 100% a guarantee I can make. And then the problem with that is I got so caught up in my new dog shampoo lifestyle that I forgot all about getting normal human people shampoo again until I ran out of the dog shampoo. And those were dark days, let me tell you. I went through my apartment and I found laundry detergent and I found dish soap. And I was like, I guess my money's on laundry detergent. Let's try this experiment out. And I'm here to report laundry detergent, that stuff burns. Laundry detergent is not shampoo. There's only one way to find that out for certain, though. That's by running the experiment. Could this be shampoo?
This is our last bit of sponsored content. We promise.
All right, everyone. I am back. I just thought that I'd come on and address all of the haters who have been talking about me in the comments recently, saying that I sold out by making this partnership with the oil field. But you guys just don't really even know, okay? Being an influencer is hard. God, I'm coming down a little bit right now. I actually have this amazing diffuser with gasoline. So good, guys. You really got to try it out. And I honestly don't know why people are so mad at me. Like, oil needs champions. Al Gore is a bully. God, I'm just getting a little agitated here. My clothes don't breathe. They're plastic. This shawl is actually a tarp that was refurbished by the Saudi military that had covered a bunch of barrels. It's vintage. Listen, your other favorite influencers are out there doing stuff like this too. They're just not as bold as me to post about it. And now you know. Anyway, catch me next week on my segment where I visit different gas stations. Peace out.
Thank you for coming. We hope you enjoyed the show. Happy Earth Day! And now, for a song about Earth.
The Last summer I went down to Queensland to swim the Great Barrier Reef. I found the coral bleached and bare, 'cause the temperatures give it so much grief. So go ahead, point your finger at everyone you see and yourself, 'cause there's no denying climate change is the product of you and me. Don't wrap yourself too tightly in a blanket of greenhouse gas. The oceans are rising and it's not surprising that you're acting like it's gonna pass. It doesn't matter what car you drive, if you fly coach or first class, look at your emissions and buy your own admission. It's bad, but not too late. Well, have you seen the recycling bin? The one for cans and glass? Okay, how about for paper or cardboard? This is such a pain in the ass. Global temperatures are warming and the ice is liquefying. There are fires, tornadoes, floods, and droughts, and it's like we're not even trying. Don't wrap yourself too tightly in a blanket of greenhouse gas. The oceans are rising and it's not surprising that you're acting like it's gonna pass. It doesn't matter what car you drive, if you fly coach or first class, look at your emissions, buy your own admission. It's bad, but not too late. Because Miami's gonna sink, Atlantic City's gonna sink, oh yeah, Jakarta's gonna sink. You know that part of New Jersey that's like across from New York? Yeah, that's probably gonna sink. I look up at other planets and they're all too cold or hot. This Earth is our only spaceship, so please be a good astronaut. Don't wrap yourself too tightly in a blanket of greenhouse gas. The oceans are rising and it's not surprising that you're acting like it's gonna pass. It doesn't matter which shrimp you fry, if your beef was fed on grass, look at your emissions and buy your own admission. It's bad. Yeah, it's pretty bad, but not too late.